This material is intended for general informational purposes only and does not constitute legal advice. The law varies by jurisdiction and is constantly changing. For legal advice, you should consult a lawyer that can apply the appropriate law to the facts in your case. Aloha, I'm Coralie Chun Matayoshi, and welcome to my legal podcast, What's the Law? Each week, you will learn valuable information about various legal topics to help you get through life's ups and downs, and even when things go sideways. So stay tuned. Now with me is Alexander Silvert, a former state and federal public defender who uncovered the Ke Aloha conspiracy and brought the case to federal authorities. His book, The Mailbox Conspiracy, provides an inside look at the greatest corruption case in Hawaii's history. Welcome, Ali.
Hello, how are you doing?
So when someone is suspected of committing a crime, law enforcement will sometimes conduct a search to find evidence at the suspect's home or business. This is what happened to Breonna Taylor and the former President Trump at Mar-a-Lago. What is search and seizure, and what does the Fourth Amendment of the Constitution protect?
So the Fourth Amendment is protects the reasonable expectation of privacy. So whenever there's an issue of privacy in your home or privacy in your vehicle or privacy in your personal belongings, the Fourth Amendment's going to apply to a search of those items and limit what law enforcement can do.
How does law enforcement obtain a search warrant, and what does this warrant say?
The process of a search warrant is a prosecutor will work with a police officer or with an agent, and they will write an affidavit that's sworn to under oath, and they will say, we believe there's probable cause that there is either a crime has been committed or evidence of a crime is going to be on a person or at a particular location. They have to spell out in particular the reasons they believe that such evidence will exist and that it will exist in a particular place or on a particular person. They then present that sworn statement to a neutral magistrate, a judge, who will review it independent of whatever law enforcement says and decide for themselves whether they believe there's probable cause to issue the warrant. The warrant will also include specifics limiting the power of the law enforcement officer when they conduct the search. It will give them a specific time to conduct the search. So it's usually a daytime search. Very rarely you can get a nighttime search, but those are exceptional circumstances. And then in addition, it'll give them a couple of days in which a time frame to execute the search. If they don't execute the search within that time limit, or they execute the search outside the narrow window of time that they're given, then the search warrant is invalid.
So what does a search warrant allow the officer to do? They are able to legally enter the premises without the permission of the occupant, but are there other things that they can do once they get in there?
So the warrant will tell the officers in particular what they can search for and in general where they can search. Mm-hmm. So let's take a gun case, and they have a probable cause to believe that someone who's a felon is in illegal possession of a warrant in their home. The officers will be allowed to go into the home, secure it for their safety. In other words, they can look through the home, make sure there's no other person present, secure the person who's in the house on a sofa or somewhere where they can't walk around. And then they can search in the particular locations where the gun might be. But for example, if you're looking for a gun, you can't look into very small items where a gun couldn't possibly be. Mm-hmm. So you're limited to those areas of the residence that a particular person has access to and those areas in the residence that could potentially hold a gun.
Mm-hmm. So are search warrants required in every search? Can someone consent to it?
Yeah, not in all circumstances do you have to have a search warrant. Mm-hmm. There are some exceptions. You consent. You can get the consent of the owner of the residence or the people living in the residence to search particular areas. There are exigent circumstances when there's an emergency. You know, the cops come to a house and they hear screaming or yelling and they think something's about to happen, or they've gotten information, someone's, you know, in danger inside the house, they can go in and do that. There's also the plain view exception, which means if law enforcement officers are at a residence where they've been called and they can see things that might be in their view, and just like you and I would, and if it's contraband or evidence of a crime, they can seize it without a warrant. So there are some limited exceptions. There's an automobile exception. When you're in your automobile, the expectation of privacy is much lower. And remember, the Fourth Amendment is all about reasonable expectation of privacy. So if you're in a car and you're driving on public road, you're going to have a lower expectation of privacy in your vehicle. So the law reflects that. And officers are allowed much more leeway when they do a traffic stop or they impound a car than they would at your home, which is much more the highest level of expectation of privacy.
So can my landlord or roommate give consent to search my home?
So those are two very different people. Yes. The landlord cannot, because you have a lease. It's now your property for the, as long as you have that lease. And the landlord, even if they have a key, can't give consent to search the residence. However, your roommate might be able to. And it also depends on how you live in the residence. So for example, your roommate has the right to give a generalized consent to search the residence, but they may not be able to give consent to search your room in the residence, unless you share the room. If it's common area and it's shared equally, even though it may be technically your room, then that roommate can give consent.
The element of surprise helps prevent hiding or destruction of evidence. What happened with Breonna Taylor's case where they wanted to execute a warrant in the middle of the night?
Right. Well, first, it was very unusual that they could do it in the middle of the night, because the danger, you know, that happens not only to the officers when you search in the middle of the night, but to the residents, because they're not expecting someone to come through your door. And that's exactly what happened here. And then we have what are called these knock and announce rules. And these vary from state to state. There's no one rule that fits everything. Hawaii has limited the knock and announce, where officers before were going and just yelling, "Police, police," and breaking through the door and coming in. Most states now require a knock and announce, where you knock and you announce your presence, and then you have to wait a certain amount of time before you come in. Hawaii has limited, it says you have to knock and announce. There's is a rule about how long you have to wait. It's somewhat flexible on the circumstances, but that's what happened in that case. They barged in. Unfortunately the boyfriend didn't know who they were and grabbed his gun, thinking they were robbers and burglars, and they exchanged gunfire, and unfortunately the boyfriend was killed. Breonna was killed.
Right. So what happens when a search does violate the Fourth Amendment? Are you home free?
you're not home free. In some cases you are, in some cases you're not. What you have to look at is this. When there's a search warrant and you think it's invalid, you can't do anything about it until you're actually charged with the crime and you're litigating the case in court. So let's say you believe there's an illegal search warrant, but you're not arrested or charged. There's nothing you can do about it because nothing's been brought against you. The illegal evidence that you think they obtained hasn't been used against you. So you just can't do anything about it. But if you're charged and you go to court and they're going to use that piece of evidence against you that they found, then you can file a motion and challenge it, the legality of it. But in some cases, and I'll give you examples, it's an all or nothing thing. In some cases, it's not. So for example, if I'm in Waikiki, and I tell this to my clients all the time, and I'm with some local guy, and it's 3 o'clock in the morning, and we're in an alley, and I'm actually talking to the person in the alley, and maybe I'm buying drugs or something, but a cop drives by, he doesn't really know what we're doing, but he kind of looks and says, you know, what's this alley guy doing with a local guy at 3 o'clock in the morning in an alley? And he comes up, and he pushes us up against the wall, he searches me, he searches the other person, and he finds marijuana in my back pocket. Well, so he arrests me and he charged me with possession of marijuana. I would file a motion to suppress saying, wait a second, this is the United States of America. I'm free to be out at any time of the day or night. And while the officer may have had a suspicion and may have even been right, that's not enough to pat me down, search me for marijuana, even though he was actually right about what he thought. That thought is not enough to justify a search. In that case, if I suppress the marijuana that was found in my pocket, I win the case because there's no evidence. That's the only evidence there is. However, let's take a bank robbery. And let's say there's evidence from photographs. There's evidence they found money at the person's home. They have a confession from someone else. But they did a lineup, and the lineup of the defendant and the tellers came out and picked out the defendant from the lineup was tainted. The officers kind of told the suspect, the victim, you know, it's number three. and that's taints the lineup, and it taints the identity. I would file a motion to suppress saying they cannot use the identification from the photo lineup as in the trial because it was tainted by illegal police conduct. I would win that motion, but I don't win the case.
Right.
Because then only that piece of evidence in the chain of evidence gets knocked out, and all the other pieces of evidence that the police have can still be used against me. And if that can convict me, then I'm still going to go to trial or plead guilty because I only knocked out a piece of the evidence.
And that's a wrap. We want to thank Ali Silwood for his time and expertise. And thank you for joining us on What's the Law. Until next time, ahoy ho.